Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the procession. Gentlemen, I would like to have your attention for Mr. Remmelt Vetkamp, CFO of Nyrode Business Universiteit.
Distinguished guests, dear Mr. Nooitgedacht, dear students, alumni and colleagues, everyone here in the Pfizer Auditorium, as well as everyone sharing this ceremony through the computer online. It is my pleasure to warmly welcome you to the opening of the academic year 2020-2021. Looking around me, obviously there is no other way to start my little welcome by addressing the special circumstances we are in. As always around this date, for almost 75 years, Nyrode celebrates the opening of a new academic year. But this year, this meeting, is most peculiar. Only a small group of invitees is physically present. The rest is in other places, following this ceremony through a live stream. Actually, that being the case, this opening ceremony is exemplary of how we at Nyrode are dealing, as best we can, with the various effects of the corona pandemic on everything we do. Exemplary in the first place, in the sense that we are carrying on with what we need to do. Normally, the Nyrode community would have been present here in large numbers. Now, we are here in a small group, and the larger group is connected through Teams. But we do celebrate the opening of the academic year. Likewise, since March 2020, our education and research operations continued, though often in different ways than before. I want to stress that whilst continuing our affairs, our main concern is safety and security. We make it our priority to adhere to the guidelines and restrictions issued by authorities like the RIVM and the Veiligheidsregio. In March 2020, we completely stopped our classes, our physical classes, therefore. Ever since, all our classes have gone digital. As you can imagine, this was a major effort involving all our staff. But in doing so, we largely succeeded to prevent study delay for especially our degree students. Nonetheless, most students and participants felt they really missed the physical gathering with fellow students and teachers. Fortunately, as of June, we have been able to gradually increase physical education once again. As of September the 1st, most of our education will be blended, which is to say that we offer a mix of physical and online gatherings. Numerous measures have been taken to enable the physical meetings. We checked the ventilation, we enabled the 1.5 meter distance in our buildings, we increased the number of cleaning rounds, we put disinfectant fluids everywhere, etc. In fact, we are all familiar with these kinds of measures in this time, which has become the new normal. Whilst taking the right measures is necessary and important, I want to place a serious appeal to you all. Please adhere to the guidelines and restrictions, because for the professional Nyenrode organization, it is impossible to take away all risks all by ourselves. We need the responsibility and the serious rigor from the whole Nyenrode community, including students, participants, teachers and employees. As the government slogan states, only together we will get corona controlled. So please let us all keep that in mind and restrict ourselves to 1.5 meter, stay home also with mild ailments and also adhere to the other rules. Ladies and gentlemen, clearly we do live in interesting times. And I can imagine you might be interested to know how Nyenrode is doing business-wise, especially for me at the pedestal as the board member responsible for our finances. Well, fortunately, I can bring you the news that we are overall happy with the enrollment in our degree programs for the new year. Though international students are hampered at times by travel restrictions, we generally observe a healthy development of student numbers. Turning our attention to the executive education, we have had a slow period from March until the summer. However, looking forward to coming months, we fortunately have a full order book and are looking forward to many participants in our diverse program portfolio in the months to come. While the immediate future looks good in this way, I find it a lot harder to predict where we will go business-wise in 2021, because the health of our business is closely related to the general economy, which in turn is closely related to the further development of the corona pandemic. In these uncertain times, we are making sure to keep our financial strength, short-term as well as long-term. The financial steering allows for flexibility and is closely tied to the development of our business. Part of our strategy is that we continue to invest in the development of blended learning and in our facilities, because we are convinced that this is needed to secure the long-term health of our university. Speaking of the quality of facilities, tomorrow the all-new Nelly Kroeshal will be taken into service. Over the summer holidays, we transformed the Nelly Kroeshal and gave it a hospitable look and feel. Also, we created a corner where you'll be able to buy a barista coffee and enjoy it in an open, accommodating and friendly environment. With that good news, I would like to finish my opening remarks and introduce Mr. van der Vat and our keynote speaker, Mr. Jan Nooitgedacht. Mr. Stijn van der Vat was vice president of the 74ste Collegie der Heren Vijf, which is last year's board of the NCV Student Association, of course. Mr. van der Vat will share with us his clear and daring view on work and working in organization. I promise you, his contribution will prove highly interesting, and I am honored that we at Nyenrode educate exceptional people like Stijn van der Vat. After Mr. van der Vat, our keynote speaker, Jan Nooitgedacht. Though, of course, he needs little introduction. Mr. Nooitgedacht serves as non-executive director in many boards, among which are PostNL, Rabobank and InvestNL. InvestNL is the company owned by the state of the Netherlands, which received 1.7 billion euros from the government to make the Netherlands more sustainable and more innovative. And next to these occupations, from 2013 until the beginning of 2020, Mr. Nooitgedacht was chairman of the Nyenrode Foundation Board, which is the sole shareholder of this university. As such, I've become well acquainted with him, and I know Mr. Nooitgedacht as a very kind man. But do not be mistaken. In his gentlemanlike way, Mr. Nooitgedacht is not afraid to voice a strong opinion on matters. I am honored to now first hand over to Mr. van der Vat and look forward to his contribution today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Vetkamp. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to have your attention for Mr. Stijn van der Vat, student Bachelor of Science in Business Administration.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is, as said, Stijn van der Vat, and I just finished my bachelor degree here at Nyenrode. I was, as Mr. Vetkamp already mentioned, vice chairman of the NCV last year, and I am now the proud commissioner, students and young professionals of Nyenrode's Alumni Association, the VCV. Today I'm honored and humble to have the opportunity of speaking about how millennials are taking over society and how I, together with Chip Steenstra and 60 other millennials, took initiative and responsibility during the corona crisis. How to deal with us? Millennials have been rapidly transforming work culture. Experts predict that by 2025, 3/4 of workers are going to be millennials. This means that in the near future, millennials will take over the baby boomers in our workplace. So you better adapt. By now, businesses and managers should have enrolled their best game plan on how to manage millennials at work. But have you? And also, how do universities adapt to this changing target group? Millennials. Generally, millennials exhibit characteristics and habits that significantly differ from the previous generations, as the age group that experiences life with the internet, but also without the internet. We are also the generation that loves technology. That GIF didn't really work. On the other hand, we are also the generation who starts crying when we don't get what we want. And we're the generation who wants freedom to do whatever they like, whenever they like. As I'm starting my own company now, I get the opportunity to speak to a lot of interesting people. And a couple of weeks ago, I spoke to a small business owner of a finance firm about my generation, and how he saw us was, your generation is a generation that sits back at the job interview asking me how I'm going to develop them. This is how we look then in a job interview. And I couldn't agree more, but instead of being critical about how my generation should change this attitude, I started wondering, of course, how others should adapt to us, because that's also my generation. Since I'm academically schooled here at Nyenrode on this beautiful estate, I, of course, started researching. And instead of judging, I would like to ask the audience, but also the people home, to just listen and be critical on the points I try to make. What we want. Millennials want a strong company culture, the freedom to do whatever they like, whenever they like, and therefore a healthy work-life balance. The freedom, but also leadership and guidance, recognition for their work, and that their work is also meaningful. To have accomplished the next step before they start the previous one, we want to work together and we want to lead and take ownership. I'm going through those points one by one. Millennials want a strong company culture. What does your company stand for? And then I don't mean only the values and words we put on paper, but how are those values and words you want to stand for as an organization resulting in a culture? Are those values and words even resulting in a culture and way of communicating towards employees, but also stakeholders? That is the ideal desired values. That the ideal desired values are not always equal to the true situation can be seen in the following short video.
Our vision is to enable e-business worldwide. What about our mission? To understand and digitize our customers' business focal points using the best software tools available and to create breathtaking customer experiences. All meanwhile, having the happiest employees.
You want a mindless yes man? Too bad, because you ain't gonna find one here. Instead, we bring our hardcore expertise and vision to the table. Did I remember to tell you that we're also one of the best places to work? Officially. Look it up.
Well, I'm not a professor, but I think this is my objective view as a bystander on how companies sometimes do not always incorporate the values and needs they want. Millennials want freedom to do whatever they like and therefore a healthy work-life balance. Last month, I got to speak with one of our alumni who said, "Why work 5 days a week if I can earn the same amount of money while working 3 days as a self-employed?" And that is exactly the mentality you see back when we look at the rise of self-employed on the picture. This need for freedom and flexibility is underlined in the article and research of PwC called "Millennials are basically contracted self-employed people." Then again, a question: how is your organization adapting to this need for freedom and flexibility? Does your organization consist of contracted employees or more self-employed entrepreneurs? Also, it is fun to see that the scream for working remote happened during the corona crisis, resulting in millennials not wanting to come back to the office, and the older generation questioning if we shouldn't come back. Millennials want freedom, but also leadership and guidance. We are result-driven, but as said, we also want control over how and when we work. We are famous for our lack of respect, especially for authority structures. Wearing a tie is old-fashioned, wearing jeans to work became acceptable, but companies like a factory started self-directed teams with mentors, coaches, instead of managers and bosses. And these self-directed teams led to many improvements as shown in research. One, high collaboration, one of the millennial needs. Improved quality, reduced operating costs, better response to workers' values, which is also one of the millennial needs for freedom, and higher commitment. Many organizations are making the transition to self-directed teams already, and the question is, have you? Also, we want recognition for our work and what that work is, and that work is meaningful. We want to feel important. Freud said that everything you and I do springs from two motives: the sex urge and the desire to be great. Dr. Drury, an American philosopher, formulates it a bit different as the desire to be important. Millennials do not want a meaningless pat on the shoulder, but we want to make impact. One of the reasons I got honored for standing here today is because of this enormous need to do something important. As said, together with my classmate and best friend Chibbe Steenstra, we started a social initiative called Student Collectief The Fuck in the beginning of March. Thanks to the corona crisis, many entrepreneurs got in trouble. And not because they did not know how to run their business, but because the circumstances were changing completely and they could not get the bird's eye view on the situations they were in. 60 students, mainly from Nairobi, of diverse but also other universities, joined our initiative to help entrepreneurs get back this bird's-eye view on the situation in an attempt of saving small and medium-sized businesses. 60 students not getting paid a cent, not getting any appreciation because the entrepreneurs were quite stressed, but working because they felt it was important and made impact. And I think that is a clear example of how crazy we millennials are. Another example is an example of an alumni and a good friend of mine working for Closure now. Closure is an organization helping relatives of those who lost their loved ones to end subscriptions at the big corporates like T-Mobile and Centraal Beheer. First, she was working immediately after Nairobi in the meat industry, where she was unsatisfied and missed the willingness to work completely. She quit her job without having a new one because, well, taking risk is also what we do. And then she came across Closure on LinkedIn, a company with a cause she believed so much in that she wrote an open motivation letter. The response of Closure was that they could not pay her salary, and especially not the salary she was worth. But because she believed in the cause, she took the lower salary and is happy with what she does every day. Millennials just want to believe the same things as the corporation they work for, which is a better motivator than salary. Millennials want to have accomplished the next step before they start the previous one. In general, millennials work very hard when having the perspectives of a higher position in mind. The best example of this is the rise of traineeships, which is in many cases a way for employers to pay a lower salary. But it works, since a traineeship brings more than money can offer, because it's offering a perspective on a higher position in the near future. Deloitte, ABB, Lidl, Cisco, Rabobank, PwC, KPMG, KLM, ABN, Buurtsuper, Douar, I think they all have a traineeship. The opposite is true, because I believe more, and that's my personal opinion, but there's also room for my personal opinion. I'm not really a big fan of all those traineeships. What I heard during my studies and see back within the companies my friends work for is that the corporates regularly offer these conversations to stimulate people to think about their career. Small businesses are a bit more controversial and are afraid of losing employees when they stimulate thinking about higher and better positions. But the opposite is true. According to the Deloitte Global Millennial Survey of 2019, 49% of the respondents said that they would quit their job within 2 years. According to this same survey, the main reasons for the need for this is the need to the millennials not feeling any appreciation, lack of learning and development opportunities, and not always getting enough opportunities to advance. This is problematic, since the possibilities for promotion within a company are not infinite. How can we solve this problem? Maybe create more steps between positions, or create the impression of promoting? Well, I don't know the answer, but I think this is something we will have to deal with in the near future. More conversations. Millennials want to lead and take ownership. One of the many things I learned from Nyroda's lecturer Herman van der Meulen is allowing others to lead and take responsibility. By showing people the trust, that you trust them completely, give them responsibility and supporting them to the fullest, so that people will not let you down. This belief is based on when people have ownership and responsibility for something, they will work harder than when people just do what they are asked to do. This mentality was incorporated within our student initiative as well, by giving teams and students the full responsibility for handling the cases of our customers. This resulted in teams finishing the cases more quickly, asking faster for new cases, and higher customer satisfaction. Great. The new normal situation. What is it like to show the millennials that we adapt our company to their needs? I think it looks like this. Millennials organization, company culture as one and only basis for existence, flexible and part-time working, self-directed teams working from home, only companies that deserve their existence thanks to their social impact, endless promotion and self-development opportunities, and endless ways of taking ownership and responsibility. Well, to come back to my first point, the small anecdote of us millennials sitting back at the job interview asking the employer how they are going to develop us. The core message I want to get across today is, let us millennials sit forward at the job interview and let us help in how we could develop those organizations. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. van der Vat. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to have your attention for Mr. Jan Nooitgedacht, former chairman, foundation board Nyroda Business Universiteit, and member of several other boards.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Stijn, for, I thought it was a keynote speech you did. Thank you. Members of the executive board, members of the foundation board, my former colleagues, professors, staff, students, alumni, dear friends. It's a great honor for me to have been invited to address you all today on the occasion of the opening of the academic year. As Remmelt has said, I have served 6 years as chairman of the board of Nyenrode Foundation. It's with a heavy heart that I'm saying goodbye to Nyenrode. Probably you will never say goodbye to Nyenrode. Happy to hear from Remmelt Vetkamp that the university is still in a very good financial shape. I have also read with great interest, I saw and read on the Nyenrode website, how the educational activities have continued, both digitally and also recently on location in Breukelen, Amsterdam. In my presentation, I like to address some of the core values of Nyenrode and their importance for society. Also the impact of the coronavirus and on the economic outlook. In general, the stakeholders model in the Netherlands. I started as an auditor, so I want to say something about the relevance of having excellent auditors, something about the fundamental changes going forward, and as Remmelt was talking about investments in energy transition, innovation, I'd like to say some words about that as well. And I will end with a few statements. Today, I want to talk about the core values of Nyenrode, and that was always amazing for me. It is leadership, entrepreneurship, and stewardship. And these values play a pivotal role in the education program offered by Nyenrode. Leadership deals with identifying opportunities, being able to act upon them, and using them to make a meaningful contribution to society. I believe that today, these times we are living in, now ask for strong leadership and bold steps. I also believe that our Prime Minister has shown leadership by immediately announcing and implementing support measures to help businesses and freelancers as ZZPers. So we'll come back to that, Stijn, as well. Entrepreneurship is characterized by proactivity and a creative spirit, which are needed to achieve results. Having a positive mindset and being optimistic are almost a sine qua non for entrepreneurs, but they are not always easy. Stewardship means recognizing and taking responsibility for the interest of others and also for future generations. Stewardship connects and balances the other values. I think these values are particularly relevant in this time of an unprecedented crisis. Governments around the world have taken unprecedented measures to combat the coronavirus outbreak. Countries around the world have been hit hard by it, not only because of the number of infections and deaths, but also because of all the measures that had to be implemented to prevent further spread, the uncertainty about additional waves, and the prospect of a possible new lockdown. The Dutch economy will suffer greatly this year due to the corona crisis, and we are likely to see only a limited recovery next year. The government has to anticipate having to make drastic losses both this and next year. This year, based on forecast from the Dutch Bureau of Economic Policy Analysis, the CPB, the economy will be shrinking by 5.1%. In comparison, the economy shrank by only 3.7% during the deep recession of 2009. And next year, we are likely to see only an economic growth of 3.2%. And this is, of course, starting at a lower level. The government is faced with rapidly rising budget deficits due to lower tax revenues in combination with the cost of the support packages. And these are intended to absorb the first blows of the corona crisis. In 2019, we still had a budget surplus of 1.7% of GDP, and we can expect now a deficit of minus 7.1% over this year, which is expected to improve slightly in 2021, namely to minus 4.1%. And if there is no second lockdown, the government debt is expected to be around 60% in 2020 and also 60% in 2021. If there is a second lockdown, government debt is expected to rise to approximately 75%. The good thing is, which is a very high number, by the way, we will be able to bear this deficit together, and compared to neighboring countries, we are doing better. Most important is that lockdowns are having a huge effect on the labor market. And the forecast of the CPB show that flex workers, so-called ZZPers, come back to that again and again, and young people are the most likely to lose their jobs. And these young people are hit even harder, as many of them do not have enough financial reserves. It is expected that the biggest effects on the labor market will become visible in 2021, after government support to businesses has expired. The uncertainty that young people are facing is a major concern, and the business community and the government have to ensure, in my view, that young people continue to have sufficient prospects of finding a suitable job. I know from experience what the long-term adverse consequences are. Even I'm a baby boomer, but in the 1980s, we also saw a recession, and consequently, no or fewer people were hired. And the impact we had, that I really believe that companies should have a well-balanced workforce, and it can take years to overcome if you don't hire young people. And I also strongly believe that millennials are very important for companies all over the world. What we are also noticing is that while the interest rates are low, very low today, the so-called savings rate increased sharply. In 2019, 3.1% of the disposable income was saved. That was already a high number if you compare with previous years. And the CPB expects that it will be 8.9% this year and 6.9% for 2021. So this is unprecedentedly high, and this again also has implications for domestic consumption, especially when you know that economic contraction in the Netherlands can be attributed for about 50% to the decrease in domestic consumption. Instead of direct support to companies, we could also think about trying to keep the demand for products and services at a stable level by providing consumers the certainty that they can continue to consume. One experiment that has piqued my interest is the trial with a basic income, which was started in Germany. A very conservative country, by the way. But 120 participants will receive a tax-free monthly income for 3 years without any quid pro quo. Of course, they can generate extra income through paid work. But a study into these effects of this basic income is scheduled to start next year. And the aim is to find out whether a basic income helps people live a healthier and more social life with less financial stress and less fear of making more daring individual choices. The study wants to know whether a basic income can make people and society more resilient in the event of a crisis. With this study, the Max Planck Institute hopes to find answers to the question of whether a basic income can free the mind, enabling people to think clearly and develop a more social and proactive attitude to life. With the basic income, the initiators of Mein Grundeinkommen hope to find answers to the major societal questions of the moment. Can a basic income reduce social insecurity and polarization? Does a basic income make people more socially aware of the environment and the climate risks? Would it be worth considering giving students a basic income in this context? Macroeconomically, we are experiencing unprecedentedly uncertain times. And governments and banks are spending billions to finance businesses and save jobs. In general, this is highly appreciated and seen as good leadership and stewardship. The unprecedented high worldwide government debt is being stimulated by the regulators of the Federal Reserve and the European Central Bank. Partly because interest rates are so low, we do not know what the longer term outcomes of this policy will be and have to take many uncertainties into account. This has prompted me to give my speech the title Leadership in Unprecedented Uncertain Times. As mentioned before, financial markets, banks, and therefore also businesses are supported by enormous programs implemented by the central banks. In the spring, the US Federal Reserve alone launched a $1,500 billion bailout package, and the European Central Bank followed with $750 billion. And these billions should keep the economy and the financial markets afloat. This has been successful for the time being as far as the financial markets are concerned. S&P 500 and Nasdaq have broken previous records already this year. Well, I think important is that we should bear in mind that the US tech companies have a strong impact on these indexes and have been very successful so far this year. When I was writing this presentation, I was really inspired by the book Ruw ontwaken uit de neoliberale droom en de eigenheid van het Europese continent. This is a philosopher, Professor Gabriel van den Brink, professor of the philosophy at the VU. And this book is mainly about the development of liberal thinking since the 1980s, which led to deregulation, privatization and the free market. And I can admit that myself and my colleagues who are from the same age, we made many mistakes. But I think it's good to read that book because you really understand where we are now today. It's clear that digitization has gained momentum. It seems that all companies that are somewhat digital have made huge strides forward during the corona crisis, with the exception of a number of sectors such as aviation, hospitality and entertainment, of course. But digital plans, companies who had digital plans and wanted to achieve these in 3 years are now almost realizing them in 3 months. Hans de Boer, the chairman of the Dutch Employers Organization, VNO-NCW, reiterated in last Wednesday's financial newspaper that we are going to see fundamental changes in the coming years in how we work together. And I agree with him. The virus caused us to start working from home almost completely overnight. For a large number of businesses and employees, this is not an ideal situation. But it will certainly be something we have to get used to, is his prediction. He also points out that in the Netherlands we are working together towards a sustainable and innovative economy with an increasingly important role for digitization. He emphasizes the importance of lifelong learning and the fact that all the stakeholders in the Netherlands, from employers and trade unions to the cabinet and the education sector, must commit themselves to this new future of learning. Another important development I see is the demand for more non-financial reporting information. Financial markets and other stakeholders feel an increasing need to be informed about financials and especially non-financial in an integrated way. A growing group of investors are exerting pressure on businesses and auditing firms to include material climate risk in their accounts. Investors are concerned that financial statements do not reflect the longer-term outlook for many businesses. The demand for mandatory rules for auditors and companies to report on climate risk is increasing. The Managing Investment Director for Board Governance and Sustainability at the largest public sector pension plan provider in the US said that ad hoc reporting on climate risks was often not overseen by auditors, not standardized, not verified, or not produced in a timely manner. And that is not good for investors. And this is the US. An executive of Schroeder said there was a need for a fundamental rethink of what companies are reporting to investors, adding that it was vital that accountancy standards took material climate risk into consideration. What gets measured gets managed. I know there are several initiatives to introduce new rules for climate risk reporting. And if we focus on the Netherlands, I feel that we should be prouder of our corporate governance structure. Since the Jaap Peters Committee, that's a long time ago, in 1997, he made his first corporate governance report. We have seen many committees since 1997, and subsequent committees have made significant contributions to the multi-stakeholder concept, what we have now today. And the most recent committee, headed by Jaap van Manen, has added important topics to the corporate governance code, such as long-term value creation, culture, executive remuneration, risk management, and diversity. As mentioned, we should be proud of how we have organized corporate governance in the Netherlands. This should also prompt our pension funds and institutional investors to invest more in Dutch funds. And these investments of Dutch institutions in Dutch stock has been very low already for a very long time. Come back to the auditors and accountants. I think that the profession of certifying accountants and the organizations have undergone an enormous development in recent years, in a positive way. The Dutch accountant is extremely professional. Still, politicians and the regulator are not yet satisfied. Even though large and listed companies are generally satisfied with their accountants, the Minister of Finance has appointed two coordinators, and one of them is Marlies de Vries of this university, Nyenrode, for a period of 3.5 years starting last May, to investigate how the quality of the accountancy profession can be better safeguarded for the future. That's at least how I interpreted the assignment. If you read the decision establishing this committee, they are giving a very broad assignment. It is very relevant, and it's also fantastic that Nyenrode is involved. And it is also, I think, the reason is probably also that 30 to 40% of accountants are Nyenrode graduates. However, I have now the opportunity to make some comments and remarks, and the following numbers of points I like to address. In the first place, what I feel, and that's not only from today, but already many years, that fraud, money laundering, and cybercrime seem to be a growing, continuing social problem. It is inconceivable for me that 1.9 billion is missing from a listed company such as Wirecard in Germany. When I read the reports by accountancy firms, it becomes clear that fraud is a growing problem. When I see to what extent banks are faced with problems caused by external fraud, this really requires a response. I do not expect that the accountant is able to solve all the problems by him or herself, but they can do more and also ensure that the entire chain is involved. Accountants have developed countless procedures to detect fraud, but the results are not yet satisfactory. Something about the training. The training for an accountant, I believe it should be much more multidisciplinary. And at the same time, this is almost unfeasible because the introduction of international accounting rules and other rules, it is very extremely complicated. An accountant is expected to have an understanding of almost everything, all disciplines, financials as well as non-financials. They have to be able to assess the tone at the top. They have to understand data analytics. Is becoming increasingly important. The work is largely based also on building models and interpreting models. And this requires even more investments in the coming years. And I think also the behavioral aspects are becoming increasingly important. The culture, I'm glad that the millennials say about the culture of the company, because I feel also that culture is becoming more and more important. How are your people doing? Do you have healthy, happy people working for you? And my question is more from, can one person do all this, or should we not start looking at developing a team with different disciplines where everybody has his own responsibility and accountability for his own discipline? In the book of Gabriel van der Brink, he makes a plea for a more cooperative structure for the whole society, the society as a whole. He indicates that both elements, the element of competition and cooperation, have to work together, and you cannot take one of the two absolute. That is, in his view, absurd. So there should be a balance between competition, cooperation in the whole society, but also within a company. And I think it is interesting to investigate whether accountancy firms apply sufficient checks and balances to comply with this concept. And obviously, the mandatory supervisory board of the accountancy firms have an important role in this respect. Last point, that is that it has been said already for many years that artificial intelligence will replace large parts of the work of accountants, auditors, and maybe also financial people. And accountants are almost on the top of the list of professions which will be fully automated. With the current acceleration in digitization, the profession must prepare, in my belief, for this change. It is a challenging development which can at the same time bring the profession to a significantly higher level and reduce the expectation gap with the users. Maybe good to say that last year was a survey conducted by chairman of audit committees. And the main conclusions from this study are that accountants are caught between regulation and flexibility. The requirements from legislators, regulators, and supervisors force accountants to focus more on traditional areas of attention. And there is a desire in the market for more added value in the form of, do you look at the bigger picture in addition to your formal control? Less compliance, more professional judgment. It's almost a profession what you say. How is it possible to satisfy everybody? The challenge that accountants face is the following. Are we able to withstand the increasing external regulatory pressure and focus more on relevance and added value? Choices have to be made on the regulation versus flexibility axis. All this without compromising on the quality and accuracy of the traditional task, because the numbers have to be checked always. Finally, in my speech, I would like to reflect on public and private investments in relation to climate risk. Is there still money available for investments in the energy transition? According to McKinsey, there are a number of fundamental similarities between the virus pandemic and our climate risks. Both are the so-called physical shocks. They also believe, and I tend to agree, that we should ask the question, what lesson can be learned from the current pandemic for climate change? We are used to financial shocks, which have an element of fear and can generally be overcome by restoring confidence. In a physical shock, like the pandemic and an acute climate crisis, the underlying physical causes need to be addressed. And the socio-economic aspects of the pandemic might give us a foretaste of what the effect could be of a serious climate crisis. The difference between the two might be that the pandemic is more directly visible and climate change is more treacherously gradual. My conclusion is that we should not wait making investments in climate-resilient infrastructures. And we should not forget that the transition to a lower carbon future will drive significant job creation. Moreover, with zero interest levels for the near future, there is no better time than to invest now. And since the end of 2019, the Dutch government has been shareholder in, at that time, at least 32 companies, and will be more today. The state-owned participations are deemed to comply, that's good to know, with the Dutch Corporate Governance Code and are an example function for corporate social responsibility and sustainability. In the annual account 2019 of the Ministry of Finance is stated that the establishment of InvestNL, which was focused on that, of course, with a lot of interest, was one of the milestones of 2019, the Ministry of Finance said. By the way, the other new investment was Air France KLM. But InvestNL invest in companies and projects which are important to the Dutch economy and which are not able to obtain sufficient financing from the financial markets. And this new vehicle focuses on financing the energy transition and innovative scale-ups. Also, in view of how we help companies to get out of the corona crisis, the establishment of InvestNL is very valuable, and we had a couple of investments already in this case, as stated by the Ministry of Finance. And in my opinion, the Dutch government has never been more involved in financing our business community since the 1980s. I know from own experience that a lot of time has been spent by the government preparing the establishment of InvestNL. It took at least 3-4 years. And that concepts such as state aid, market failure, competitive returns, and market demands are thoroughly investigated. It takes too long to go in more detail, but I like to conclude my speech as follows. COVID-19 pandemic has caused social and economic disruption, globally and locally. Fear from losing jobs and uncertainty about economic outlooks are increasing. This may also lead to more stress and social unrest. Politicians and business leaders have to make sure that young people and economically disadvantaged have sufficient chances in finding jobs. If not, some sort of compensation like a basic income should be made possible. I believe that working environments will fundamentally change. Working from home will continue, investments in digitization will increase, permanent education is needed for broadening skill set and for making new and alternative career steps possible. Business leaders will spend more time on strategies, choices between global and local activities, social, culture, and health aspects of their personnel. There will be pressure to increase productivity by making the organization more efficient and effective. I think this is a danger. At the same time, I feel that there is a need for having informal meetings to keep the coffee drinks at the coffee bar, at Kopje Koffie, is very necessary for informal meetings. Low and negative, even negative interest rates in combination with increasing debts are unprecedented. We are not able to give answers to questions like, are risks priced adequately? Are companies valued correctly at stock markets? How to pay future pensions? How to reduce sovereign debts? I also believe that the corporate governance code in the Netherlands is based on stakeholders' value. This is a great achievement of all parties involved. With increased focus on non-financial information, all stakeholders will get a better insight in the business of the company. I also believe that we should make use of this corporate code as a strong element in the discussion to attract companies to the Netherlands. Auditors can bridge the expectation gap by investing substantially more in artificial intelligence and data analytics. By doing so and making more time available for more soft elements like behavioral and organizational aspects, and by contributing more to the discussion how to detect and prevent fraud and how to protect ourselves against cyber criminality, it will make the auditors even more relevant. Governmental investments and private investments are both needed to achieve our sustainable goals. Both parties benefit from working together and exchanging staff and their views. There is enough financing available to invest now. And my last point is Nyenrode is very well positioned to educate students and professionals based on their core values, leadership, entrepreneurship, and stewardship. And especially in a crisis like today, I think permanent learning is essential. I also hope, and this is a real hope, that universities can play a decisive role in safeguarding facts and figures. We are living in times in which alternative facts or fake news exist. And surprisingly, they do have an audience. And I believe all of us, politicians, professors, supervisors, business leaders, investors, journalists, have a role to play here. Ladies and gentlemen, I continue to be optimistic about our future and the future of Nyenrode. There is a lot to do, but I also believe that much can be achieved with the right mindset. Thank you all for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Nooitgedacht. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention for Professor Misha Djodic, Rector Magnificus.
Dear students, faculty, staff, alumni, and friends of Nyenrode, in the first place I would like to thank our two speakers of today. Stijn van der Vat showed us how a group of bachelor students just graduated, confronted with unprecedented situation, demonstrated responsible leadership, and helped many entrepreneurs during a very difficult period. On the other hand, I also learned a lot about millennials. After managing students for a while, I think I am ready to step up to the next challenge and start managing millennials. On the other hand, if they all look like Stijn, it's going to be a great pleasure to work with them. Now, and then Jan Nooitgedacht gave a wonderful, sometimes provocative, extremely rich lecture, also inspiring speech, and I would like to thank you for that. I would like to thank you for, certainly for also the positive final message for the coming period. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, also your concern about the job challenges for the younger generation, as much as I appreciate the period that we have been working together. Jan Nooitgedacht is the chairman of the foundation board and actually my supervisory board, and I had the privilege to be the chairman of the university board. And I thank you for the keynote speech, but I also thank you for the wonderful cooperation that we had. The university is going forward, a new era, with a new chairman of the foundation board and very soon also a new chairman of the university board. Therefore, the opening of this academic year, especially this year, is obviously an opening of a new phase for many of us. First year students, that's for sure, but also for the faculty. And it is very difficult to open a new year without at least reflecting on the past 6 months that were challenging in many ways. I think that the past 6 months, we all worked very hard together and everybody persevered to accomplish our mission at Nyenrode. And meanwhile, we have been also working on the strategy with a lot of new ambitions and a lot of new ideas. A totally new era with a lot of new things. And although a lot of things change, one thing remained the same. I would say obviously remained the same. And that is our mission. Our mission, in fact, everything we have been doing since the founding moments of this university after the Second World War, is to serve society by shaping responsible leaders. And while we have been positioned in the extraordinary situation by this pandemic, I think we all did our best to do exactly that. Students, faculty, staff, we as a Nyenrode community made it work. We provided and received education in difficult and pretty challenging circumstances. And the education continued without any delay, I would say, so that the diplomas could be received in time and the planning of careers and lives of many could simply continue. But while our mission is to serve society by shaping responsible leaders, let us not forget that in the last 6 months, the society also very much served us. I think during the first 3 months, while we were all at home, our healthcare workers, nurses and doctors, did not distance themselves. On the contrary, they were in the midst of pandemic, helping us if we needed it. And then, in the next 3 months, again, we have been served by the society, this time with knowledge. And just as Jan said, there is a lot of fake news, alternative news, conspiracy theories, but for those that do want to listen, there were scientists out there to show us and to explain to us new and relevant information about this new virus and this new disease. And that too is important to acknowledge. It is clear that the first and basic advice that we have been given in that time is social distancing. And it sounds very easy, but we all experience that it's very difficult to comply to over a prolonged period of time. There are many examples of that. And I understand it. We are humans, social beings, and even if disease of this magnitude cannot obviously prevent us to looking after each other, find each other, and getting close to each other. But nevertheless, the fact that we do know how to influence the spread of the disease is very helpful. And at the university, we are doing our best, students and faculty and supporting staff, to limit the impact of the virus and therefore try to limit the transmission and the infections as much as we can. Social distancing, how difficult can it be? The word says it. We should keep distance, that famous 1.5 meter. But it doesn't say anything, that social distancing, about connection between people. And therefore, despite that for the coming period of time, maybe even a year, we will have to keep that social distancing as a way of life, yep, we can still remain connected. In the past 6 months, despite all the difficulties, I've seen faculty coming together online. And despite all the limitations, I've seen some of our classroom, just as Remmelt said, starting already in time. I've seen supporting staff making all kinds of plans to accommodate many of our programs in a safe way. And this is just one of the many meetings, even under all kinds of restrictions and all kinds of limitations. And I've seen a steep learning curve and discovery of new possibilities and opportunities when it comes to teaching formats and indeed establishing connection or re-establishing connection between faculty and the students and between faculty themselves. If I have to summarize these past 6 months, I would say the urge to connect sparks creativity. With that in mind, especially in uncertain times, we will stay connected and keep our network alive, and a dedicated Nairodo community will serve the society like we have done for almost past 74 years. And with these words, I would like to open this new and exciting academic year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Jolic. Ladies and gentlemen, that completes the ceremonial part of the opening of the academic year. Please stay in your place until the procession has left. Thank you very much. Please rise for the procession.